wonderful when it outdoor pieces of sculptures, you know, made of old iron.
Hello everybody, thank you for coming and welcome. Well, welcome to my illustrated talk. You're going to see lots and lots of pictures and you'll hear lots of words from me. And it's a fast-paced journey through the world of colour and I'm going to touch on every aspect of it. And the reason why I'm doing that is because you'll see after the break, in the end, you, my audience, are going to show what you've learned from my talk and you're going to judge the pictures that I'm going to have on the screen. And I hope you find it fun, because I certainly found it fun putting it together. Thank you. And yes, that involves a bit of audience participation. A bit slow on the slides there. So first of all, I thought I'd fill you in about me and my background, because people have heard rumours, and I thought I'd get rid of the rumours and tell you the facts. So at age 6, I was already drawing people and doing things and having adventures. And one of those adventures was, I had a group of 5 friends and we all used to get together regularly and we'd create a theatre. And we'd decide on the plot of the play and the characters involved and then we'd paint them or draw them. And then we'd stick them on sticks and make ourselves a little TV set through which we would put these characters through the bottom. And that kept us amused for ages, and all our parents were so thankful. But that was my first journey into the world of art. And then, at age 10, the junior schools in Hertfordshire had a competition, and they were looking for child artists who were, it's a competition, for them to send their pictures up to the children's gallery at the RA. And I was very lucky to be selected from my school. And the picture was a snow scene. It was a village with a little shop with dimpled windows, sort of Georgian style, a man and a woman and a baby in a pram, a boy with a hoop, you know, running through the street, a group of children building a snowman. And I wish I had it now, because we didn't understand about collecting them at the end of the exhibition. But never mind, it was fun. Aged 18, I was working in advertising, but my problem was I couldn't keep out of the studio. I'd always wanted to be an artist, and I didn't get in. I had two opportunities I didn't get into art college. So I spent a lot of time moping about. And I hung around the studios and got the sack. But I wasn't daunted. Age 20, I was working at Craig Norman Craig and Kummel, an advertising company, a large one, American owned, and I ended up in their print department, and that was great fun. And well, life went on, and I got married, and age 28, I was divorced with a child. So I had to start earning a living for real. What I did was I swapped my home, a little semi, tiny semi, for a letting house in Harrow in the town. And over the next 7 years, I built it up to a 28-bedroom licensed hotel. A lot of hard work, but kept me off the streets. But what I did at the same time was I took O-levels and A-levels in a year. I was just determined not to waste any more time. And then I took a humanities degree. The first year I took music, history, history of art, literature and psychology. And I always loved music, always loved history, and history of art blew my mind. And I ended up majoring in literature and psychology because I wanted a profession, but I never lost my love of art. I got an MSc in occupational psychology and I ran seminars at my hotel. And they were well reported. And then I became a chartered psychologist and I ended up moving to Brighton to another hotel. But when I was in Brighton, I didn't let it go either. I continued, I was a member of the, well, fellow of the Institute of Directors when I was working, and I was on committees there, and I ended up teaching at the University of Sussex for a little while, psychology, and again, hanging out with the artists and the photographers. Psychological interests. My main reason for being is to help people understand things better and healing the mind and the body, because I believe that they're connected. I'm a bit of a Jungian, actually. And I worked with cognitive behaviour therapy, hypnosis and counselling. And I came across the Lucia colour therapy test when working with a group, helping and supporting them in their practice. And they were a group of psychiatrists, actually. I started using the test, but I didn't really enjoy it. I'm going to tell you about it later because it's an interesting concept, but so complicated that you have to have a degree in maths to be able to understand it, which I haven't. And I liked vibrational medicine. I became a Reiki healing master, and I work with meditation and changing minds to change lives. And I always found that if you directed the therapy towards making changes in people's life, that would help solve their issues, and often it did. And I also looked at the effects of colours on the whole body health and wellness, and that came from different aspects. It came with moving in a circle of people that were involved in health, and a lot of them used colour. Well, you'll hear more about that in a moment. I looked at colours and mood. I've written papers on it, and colours to impress and influence through guiding people to power dressing through work, because my qualifications were in occupational psychology, so I worked with a lot of companies. I worked with a lot of people who were wanting to provide uniforms for staff and things, and I didn't want them to do something that would affect them in any way or give them more stress. And so they had consultations. And it was interesting to see how things were affecting mood in interiors. And I often gave advice too on recreation rooms, the colours that they should prefer, and work rooms, and rooms where people were going to study or take exams. And that was a very interesting period of my work. So I also work with companies to design seminars, training days and workshops. And I offered individual counselling and therapy, including colour therapy, which I enjoyed. So, colour and our world. The earliest colours used by man was what was found around their living space, often within it. They might have charcoal from the fire, or they might rub the walls and find that they've got ochre that they can draw with, or even animal blood as they're preparing their food for cooking. And they might blow it through their hand to make a handprint on the wall. And there's been evidence that this has actually been found. And it's a way of mankind making their mark on their environment. And the cave paintings tell us so much about the people living in them. And they used colours by mixing products around them with animal fat, blood, water, sometimes egg, because egg was a binder. And these have been found in the Dordogne in France and on the Spanish border. Now, closer to home, in the Clearwell mines in the Forest of Dean, red ochre was discovered, just lying there, just, you know, over the years, ground down by water going into the caves, bashing against the side of the wall, and reducing the ochre in the wall, in the side of the cavern, into powder. In order for iron ore to develop over a very long time, enabling tools to be created, iron filings needed salty water and oxygen to help it change. Cena bacteria, of which I've never seen, have you? I haven't. No, developed in the water, and it used sunlight and photosynthesis, which is carbon dioxide and sunlight and water combined, to produce food to sustain itself. And they developed in huge numbers. And the waste products of that process is oxygen, and that's what gave our planet oxygen, and that's what allowed other things to develop. And that process in the ocean formed solid iron oxide and eventually a red colour. As the oceans receded, red ochre was found in caves and land. So we're back to the beginning now. So at the bottom, the pictures, on the right-hand side, you can see the result of the process of photosynthesis, which sustained the life forms that developed. Within the vegetation life form, chlorophyll captures the sunlight, resulting in the colour green. And that was our first colour green. And then on the left, you can see the red ochre in rocks, and on the surface of our land on the left, that's yellow ochre and red ochre. And within the vegetation life form, the chlorophyll captures the sunlight, resulting in the colour green on the right. Today, the colour green is often produced by using hematite and grinding it down. It's a lovely colour. Many of our modern artist colours are created, or rather manufactured, but it's possible to still obtain the original colour powders in Turkish or Far Eastern markets. And I hope you can see a sample there, because they're such beautiful colours. Now, this comes to our world, colour in our world, and we're looking at gold and yellow at the moment. And of course, we know very well about Egypt and their mining for gold and how they used it. They used it as a decorative form, and of course for jewellery, collars around the neck. And we're so used to associating the colour gold with Egypt, it's easy to forget that a very large cost of mining that glorious substance that the Egyptians were so fond of. The chemistry of gold reflects a yellow and red shine as if it's generating a light of its own, also beloved of the Inca and the Mayan race. To them, it represents the giver of life and radiator of energy. It's believed gold was created by a massive explosion of, say, a supernova, or the creation of a black hole. Mixtures of metals lying on the surface of the world was dragged down into the structure of the earth. Those materials contain a structure of precious metals, and when striking the earth during a bombardment, it could account for the creation of surface gold, i.e. in California. And that's attributed to Professor Brian Cox and his programme, The Planets, recently. There are about 400 tombs around the Nile. It's amazing to think that there are so many, and some we haven't even found yet. The paintings that have been discovered inside them tell stories of rulers, battles, life represented at all levels. They believed that life began in chaos and order was necessary to promote order in the afterlife. And they felt that in the afterlife, everyone developed and became more than they were. And to ensure the ruler had all that was needed to sustain his position in the next life, one earned the right to ascend the hierarchy. And all were important in the society, from the king down to the lowest. And each of them were expected to work diligently, be polite and caring to others, and thus work their way up through reincarnation into being a great ruler, maybe themselves. They used orange, green for vegetation, yellow for the sun, blue for the life-supporting Nile, the sky at night, and ascending to the afterlife through the star groups. And if any of you are fond of Egyptian art, you've probably come across those colours. They're really beautiful. Egyptians used copper to fill cracks, and hot water dissolves copper into seams. So they would fill in any gaps, or if they wanted to smooth the wall that they were going to paint on, they'd do the same. So they were familiar with copper. And in the Dead Sea Mountains, they found orpiment, which is a bright yellow, and realgar, which is orange. They also imported lapis lazuli, trading with Afghanistan and Constantinople, which was part of an extensive trade network, which I'm going to touch on a bit later because it's just so interesting. They also used malachite. When mixing malachite with sand and heating it to 1,000 degrees, it created a blue glaze, which is called Egyptian blue pigment. And if you've ever been to Egypt, you will know that loads of souvenirs are covered in blue, a blue glaze. And it's everywhere, but they really, really adore that colour. It's a little bit cheaper than lapis as well. So their gold was mined in the desert too. In 711 AD, the Arabs reached Spain, and they remained for seven centuries. The effects of their visit is still to be seen today. Aristotle believed that the earth was produced by combining four essences: earth, air, fire, and water. Therefore, all materials came from those four materials. And the Arabs tested it out and searched for the recipe to convert rocks to gold. I think they were one of the first to do that. And they brought with them the concepts of science and mathematics, and it spread out very quickly. They did discover cinnabar, which sparkles, and for them they thought at first that they had found gold, but it wasn't. And they combined mercury and sulfur, which is found in cinnabar. They crushed it and heated it, but they didn't find gold, but they did discover vermilion. It's another product that they could market. And the colours that the Arabs discovered over the next 400 years transformed the artist's palette. Now, this, believe it or not, is the Silk Road route. And it stretches here all the way from Constantinople. In fact, it does go on to Italy. That's where most Europeans picked up the route if they wanted to trade, or if they wanted to go in search of medical understanding, which was very prevalent in the East and the Far East. There were schools there where you could go and learn the latest science. You could decide, if you wanted to go by boat. The blue map, the blue line shows the route by water, but then of course you've got to pay your way on that. And your health, you would have to take herbs, medicinal, and something that you could rely on, like some really good fortified wine in case you got you needed a boost. And you might have pure alcohol, which you could use for cleansing things so that you didn't get digestive issues. And of course, your safety was paramount. Most people had arms. But if you did get where you wanted to go, there were so many things that you could trade. A lot of people took linens from Europe and things that they could exchange comfortably. And some people took furs and exchange those in the markets in Arabia, whatever. And now I want to talk about another way of showing status, and that's the role of pictures in society. Now, a lot of early paintings were religious paintings, and it's true to say that the religious churches held very, very big coffers. You only have to look at Rome today. How wealthy it is. It's a nation all of its own now. A lot of the ideas behind commissioning pictures of oneself is to show how grand you are, how wealthy you are, how important you are. It's modern marketing in the old days. And so we get used to seeing kings and queens and the aristocracy dressed in their finest. If you've ever been to the National Picture Gallery, you know what I'm talking about. I wish I could paint that jewellery the way that the artists did in those days. And of course, if you were good, you earned a lot of money by doing it. It took months and months and months, years even, to get these things right. And they had to be kept during that period. So you had to have a lot of money to be able to commission somebody. But it did show who was important in their opinion and who was less important because they couldn't afford a picture on their wall. And merchants, well, obviously in the, not so much in the 1700s, but in the 1800s, they were doing the same. They got the idea that if you want to develop your business and make more money, then people have got to hear about you. And the way that people can hear about you is by having a very extravagant picture on your wall and gossip amongst all your near neighbours or far neighbours, you know, would get the word around that this is someone to be reckoned with. But if you compare that concept of money speaking, which we all understand, with that of Egypt's concept of shared divine purpose and reward, it's subtly different. Although they were no less rich or no less decorated, they liked to walk around looking important too. But it just shows that there are parallels, only we do it a bit differently. So now I've come to Sir Isaac Newton's colour wheel, and this is when we really get into colours. So scientists believe that light of different colours, which is reflected into the eye, indirectly affects the centre of the emotions via the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland, thus affecting our mind, as well as the well-known effects that colour energy can have on our body. And we all know that we have likes and dislikes of colours, but the vibrational frequency of a particular colour can also have an effect on us too. This can be dependent upon personality type, life experiences, or it can be to do with many other reasons. We just have grown up with a house full of brown, as I did, and really don't like the colour. So it can have quite a big effect on you. I just want to talk about the colour wheel here for a minute. Now, he aligned the colours in the spectrum on the right with the notes on, you know, the musical notes. And he said that the tones vibrated similarly to each other. The diagram, which is not very clear, on the left shows them. It shows the notes as they are associated with the colour. For example, the note E represents orange, and F represents yellow, and G is green, and A is blue, and B is indigo, and C is violet, and D is red. He was an analytical scientist, and whilst examining the prism, he discovered that it changed a beam of sunlight into narrow bands of colour, which we all know, the rainbow. And as I've just said, he placed these colours alongside musical notes and the seven major planets. And this illustration is attributed to Cyril Bernese. On the other hand, Johann Wolfgang Goethe, he had his theory of colours, circa 1840, but he looked at the energy produced. So that's where my former statement comes from. He was a poet, philosopher. He was more concerned with how colours are perceived. You can see the artist in him, if you like, the poet. And his colour wheel contained only six colours, but he did introduce the concept of complementary colours, dropping pure red and indigo in preference to magenta. And these days we include magenta too. It's an important colour. He believed that the spectrum occurred where colours overlap. He thought that certain colours had properties within them that could be perceived by observers. You see a colour, perhaps someone's wearing something you particularly like, and it does something to you, to your body. You're kind of almost drawn to it. You might identify with that feeling. Think of Turner in his London studio, and about 100 years later, Mondrian in Paris. They both used colour in that way, you know, enticingly. One thing that's interesting, yin colours are cool colours, green, turquoise, blue and violet. And these are given the female characteristic, as in the Eastern concept of yin and yang. And so the moon is supposedly controlled by the feminine, the yin, and the sun, which would also correspond to red, orange and yellow, warm colours, are yang, which are considered to be more masculine and also vibrant and energetic. So hence the man, of course. Another aspect of Goethe's work is that he believed that colour affected humans. So, colour vibrations, what this says to us, so now we're going further and looking at the effects. Light of different colours reflected into the eye indirectly affects the centre of the emotions via the hypothalamus and the pituitary gland. It has an effect on our mind as well as it having an effect on our body, and that's where the concept of healing with colour comes from, because the vibrational energy can be registered within us as well as on the outside of us. So we know that we all have likes and dislikes about certain colours, but the vibrational frequency of a particular colour can also have an effect on us too. And this can be dependent upon our personality type, of course, and also our life experiences and many other reasons. We could be receptive or not. We could say, oh, total rubbish, and ignore it. Max Lucia developed his Lucia colour test as a way of reaching out and communicating with his patients who were catatonic, depressed, and withdrawn. He believed that the test was a way of bypassing their state and working on their emotions. They didn't have to respond verbally. Let them be silent. But they might react emotionally to the colour and show some kind of body reaction. And it's true, it did. And the vibrationary frequencies is what actually does the healing. The colour is kind of a byproduct. Now, can I just ask you, my audience, what your likes and dislikes are? And maybe even why? Who's prepared to volunteer? Thank you.
Well, I painted my bedroom sky blue 12 years ago because I felt I wanted colour in it, and I had gold colour curtains, yellowish gold, because it reminded me of the sun, and the blue reminded me of the sky.
Oh, how lovely.
But very relaxing.
Yes. I'll come to the colours shortly, but that's true, it is relaxing. And the gold is lovely. Yeah, well done. Anyone else? Come on, you. Wake up. Well, I'll just show an incident. I once, when I was in my hotel in Harrow, I had a little suite on the ground floor, and I decided I would paint my bedroom wall behind my bed black. And everyone said, oh, don't do that. Oh, I painted it black, and it was shiny black. It was gloss. And I absolutely loved it for about 3 days. And then I found I got depressed. I was so depressed. Honestly, it's true. And I had to have it taken down. I had to have the wallpaper stripped off as well, because the gloss paint had stuck so hard, you just couldn't peel off the top surface. So I ended up spending a lot of money in getting it back to the original colour, which I think was a whitey beige colour. But I did feel better when it was gone. Anyone else?
I like yellow. I once had bright yellow curtains in my bedroom, and then sometime later changed the colour scheme to blue and painted the walls pale blue, and that depressed me.
Really?
I had to change the walls back to a kind of a brighter colour.
Yes. Now that says to me quite a lot. It's because I like yellow too. I can't wear it anymore because my skin's changed colour. And when I put it on, I have to keep taking it off because it's a bit bright for me these days. But yellow is the colour that stimulates the mind. And if you're that kind of mentally active person that enjoys thinking and likes to have your mind stimulated with information and facts, you will love that colour. And a lot of people like the colour, but they can't be with it for long because it's too overstimulating for some people. And that's what I was saying earlier about its individual differences. And that can be stimulated by your biochemistry. Everyone's biochemistry internally is different. And maybe that has an effect, we don't know yet. But so what one person likes, another person can't tolerate.
Light green, pale green.
Pale green. It's one of the most restful colours, and it's a soothing colour, especially if you've been unwell. It's really good.
In boardrooms, they paint the walls pale green.
Mm. Yes, they do.
It's relaxing when
not so many arguments around the table.
Yes, yes. Mm. But your favourite colour, even if it's red, which is mine, I wouldn't dream of having it. Red.
No.
But it's
no. Except if you go into some fairly posh restaurants, you'll find that a lot of the walls are I wouldn't say claret. Claret is too light. A really dark red, and the reason for that is that it makes you a little bit soppified, and you linger on the table longer and spend more money on another course and another coffee. So,
I was going to say, a certain person, who I won't mention, could not stand anything that was orange. So explain why.
Because it's a colour associated with activity, physical activity, and and it's a hot colour. So it's in the hot rays rather than the cold rays, which is blue and green. Colour vibrations, the effect on mind and body. Having given you some information about what philosophers in the past and psychologists of the present and healers believed about the meaning of colour choice, I can only leave it up to you to decipher what you think. Notice here on this slide that illustrations are of the eye and how we see colours, plus the infrared and ultraviolet range. Now, the second one on the right is the ultraviolet. The middle colour is the spectrum, visible light, and the one at the bottom is infrared. If things are sluggish, it will stimulate you, whereas ultraviolet has a calming effect, a very calming effect. And if you have inflammation, like arthritis, it's very good in short doses for that, but you mustn't overdo it. So I have a few items to briefly show you on the next slide, and these relate to colour choices from a personal stylist, a colour healer, chakra meditation for improving health, or for creating colour-infused water. The top left is, if you can see, a white box with a colour film of cellophane on it. And that is an absent healing box. The idea was that you'd put a photo of someone that you want to send healing to in the opening in the box underneath, and you'd put the right coloured film on top, and that would generate through the ether to that person. Take it or leave it, I'm just telling you. The top middle is a Colour Me Beautiful pouch with the colours that were designated for that person. You know, it's they used to go and you'd go for a reading and they'd tell you which are the best colours for you according to your skin tone and and your hair colouring and your eyes. The one on the right is Aurasoma cards, and that is the same as the Aurasoma bottles, the mixture of oil and liquid, coloured liquid, usually two in a bottle, two on a card, and you'd have a reading. I don't know how to do it, but you'd have a reading for that, and that would result in giving you advice on how to improve your health and your lifestyle. Middle row is a colour flare image cards. The circle is the ones that you would get. I had a friend who was an agent of colour flare, and she did a reading for me, and that's the one that she gave me. And that's a spring, if anyone's interested. It's spring, summer, autumn, winter. All the colours divided according to hue and tone. And then on the right are Know Yourself cards. That's another way of telling your characteristics, your personality and your fortune. It's their fortune divining. The bottom ones are the most interesting ones because these are actually used medically but in larger sizes. They're cellophane colour cards for internal healing, and you put them over a light. In the medical sense, you would have quite a large spotlight, and you'd have a large cellophane of a colour that was designated, and then you'd sit under there for a while or lie, and the colour would sort of be absorbed into your body. Actually, not the colour, but the frequency. But you will see a coloured light. And as I said earlier, with the infrared and ultraviolet, that's the same system, but different degrees. And now we come on to the colours. Lovely. So, depending on how patient you want to be, I can read these to you. I can read you the short form, and then I can tell you how it affects your interiors and what should we go for. Are you interested in learning more? Yes, lots of nods. Okay, I'll carry on then. Red stands for passion, warmth and excitement. And I don't know about you, but I actually, in my bag here, I've got a long red cardigan, and I absolutely love it, but it's too hot today. Pink, love, affection, kind-hearted. It's a soft colour, and it calms people down. Orange, vibrant, sociable, energetic, which is what I said to Sue. Sometimes too energetic for a lot of people, because it really does work on the physical. Yellow, friendly, intelligent and thoughtful. Green, well-balanced, gentle and calming. Turquoise, sympathetic, expressive, freedom-loving. Blue, peaceful, quiet, creative. Indigo, well-balanced, understanding, good negotiator. Violet, wise, concerned and spiritual. You can see where we've adopted it in the physical world. And magenta, objective, intuitive, knowing and detached. A lot of very spiritual people seem to surround themselves with magenta and violet. I know when I do meditation, I always see violet and magenta in somewhere in the back of my eyes. White, youthful, innocence, honest and authoritative. Remember that when I show you pictures in the second half, and you can tell me what you're seeing. Grey, now this is where we begin to touch on power dressing. Grey tends to indicate people that are secretive, cautious and composed. Now, if you're in politics and you're in the opposition, you don't usually go around dressed in black, the biggest power colour, which is the next one on my list, which indicates protective, dignified and controlling. Because you want to be subtle, you want to work in the background. There's no point in shouting your head off your principles if you've no way of affecting them. So, at least that's how it used to be. So you would wear grey, a grey suit, maybe a red tie to show that you've got something to say, you've got, you know, you want to be noticed, or a yellow tie, I'm intelligent and intellectual, and so on. A blue tie, I'm very cool, I'm biding my time. And then there's gold. People that surround themselves with a lot of gold tend to be ambitious, exciting, and motivated. They're go-getters. And silver, nurturing, relaxing, and introspective. That's the female principle all over again. See, gold, male, silver, female. And I'm saying it that way, not because I believe it, but because that's how it's generally accepted. Now, would you like to know colours and their effects? And this is kind of showing outwardly from you, or how you can influence others. So indigo, dark, dark blue, makes you seem in control. Navy blue is the power colour for business. Well, one of two. Green, very healing. It physically does seem to make people feel that they're recovering. Pink helps deal with the emotions. Yellow, friendly and cheerful, used for short periods. As I said, it can affect the nervous system. Orange gives social strength and energy. If you are a little bit shy and you're going to a party or you're going to a business meeting and you're nervous, wear orange, because not only people will notice you and warm to you and maybe speak to you more, but also it'll give you a little boost of energy. Red stimulates circulation and strength, and it's attracting and warm, again, as I said about wearing orange, or you could wear red. Now, this business about stimulating the circulation, it does. So if you feel cold or maybe a bit down, you could wear a red cardigan or something, might help. And my son, he was a goth for a while, but I noticed his personality changing. He became very depressed. So one day I came home with a new pair of pyjamas for him, and they were male paisley, you know, little pattern, dark maroon, magenta. But also it had splashes of yellow and orange in it, and he didn't mind it because he liked the fact that they were maroon. And he wore those and he did liven up. It was amazing. And he didn't even know. Naughty, aren't I? So black is protective, usually conceals uncertainty or doubts. It's a power colour for business. It says, I am the boss. I'm in charge. And grey, undecisive, middle of the road, hence used by politicians in opposition. I've even written it here. White, non-denominational, innocent, pure, trustworthy. Brown, not so popular as blue, but it's a power colour for dark-skinned people. When worn with white or pastels, it looks very imposing. And cream, colours of elegance and wealth. It says, I can afford dry cleaning and I don't mind. I have a lot of clothes and I can change them frequently. These are unconscious messages. Do you know what I mean? It's true. And now we're going to get on to the really interesting part, because this is where I stop work and you start. I think you'll find it entertaining, and hopefully we can all share from each other. Because I've talked you through the colours and what they do in terms of health, what they do in terms of appearance, and what they do generally, and how they can help support you. So now we're going to look at some artists' unusual work, maybe the ones that you're not used to seeing. Well, maybe you have. But then you will be able to have a look and give your own views of what you think, A, is going on in the picture, and what the colours are telling you, and what you think the artist meant when he chose those colours. So did he have something in mind that drew him to those colours? Or were they just the colours of what everyone was wearing, etc., the environment? So now we're going to look at some pictures here. This is Whistler, but these are less known, pictures done by him. They're not of ships or the sea or storms or anything like that. So now I'm going to ask you, the one on the left, Whistler in his studio. There are two women chatting to each other, and the real secret of the picture is it's a self-portrait. Whistler's on the right-hand side, still a fairly young man, and he's looking out at the general public. So anyone hazard a guess as to what is going on?
I can't see very clearly.
Can't you?
But it looks, there's one in yellow, one in white.
Yes.
One signifying maybe intellectual stimulation, the other purity, other things.
Yes, innocence maybe. Yeah. Hmm, interesting. He's wearing a kind of blue, light blue, which is a tranquil colour. And he's got his palette in his hand. You can't quite make it out because it's diluted by the screen. And a gold mirror behind. I can't make out what the hangings are with the yellow. And lots of shiny stuff above and behind the two girls. Yes, that's a mirror.
No, I'm talking a mirror looking. He's looking.
Yes.
These people sitting down in the yeah. mirror. So you can see the mirror.
And paint them in his picture.
But, you know, across the room.
Yes, I get that. I understand that. So he's seeing the reflection of the girls and he's painting them in the picture that you can't see.
Yeah.
But it's very interesting. Anyone else got any ideas? The significance of the conversation, maybe. That... they're in a world of their own and ignoring him. And yet the one in yellow looks like she's looking in a mirror. So maybe she's in reflective mood, an intelligent, reflective woman, thinking about maybe the relationship he's having with the other woman.
Maybe they've had an argument because they look like they're back to back.
Yes.
So they've fallen out.
Yes, interesting. Okay, what about Annabelle Lee?
There is a painting about in French, which means I sow in all wind.
Oh, right, okay. Well, I don't know the picture, and I chose it, well, thinking that people might not, but thank you for that.
You know, there yes? is a very famous She's... picture, painting where the person has seeds in her hand.
And she's throwing them out.
She's...
Yes. Yes, that's very interesting. She's standing on solid ground. It's
Is that a flower or a shell at her side?
I'm going to have to have a look. Excuse me. You still can't make it out. It's like, it is a flower, yes. Looks like it's growing in the earth. And it could be sowing seeds. Looks like the ocean, though, sowing them onto the ocean. Yes, but in a philosophical sense or an intellectual sense, that could be very well what's happening. Sowing onto the waters to see what returns. Yeah. And the colours. When you see the picture in print, it's quite a lot of ambers and peachy colours in it, warm colours. Caring person, pale blue wrap she's got around her.
Probably just taking a stroll.
You're too down to earth.
Very serene.
Yes, I would say. A humanitarian and serene, calm, quietly doing what she needs to do. Okay, let's try another one. Now, this is one of my very favourite pictures, and I took a photo of it. It's on the hall, in my hall, on my wall. It's a print. I can't afford anything more than that. But, so, from what you can see, what would you interpret it as? It's by Henri Rousseau, and it's called The Snake Charmer, and that gives it away, in a way, because when you first look at it, you might not notice.
Snakes on the ground.
No, they're not. I'll have to tell you because you probably won't see it. But the snake is around the figure's shoulders. Can you see the figure?
Yes. See the figure, but not the snake.
Yeah, so the snake is around her shoulders and she's blowing on a pipe, so she's the snake charmer. But you can't really see her, except when you're up close, you can see the whites of her eyes. And she has a bird almost at her feet, a lot of tropical foliage, and the foliage is picked out in the lightest of colours. So what do you think it's telling you about her?
Evening scripts.
Could be evening, yes. Maybe that's the moon in the sky rather than the sun. Pardon?
She's very restful.
Mm. Yes. She's very at one with herself. And maybe she doesn't want to be seen. She works in secret. Yes. And the foliage is light. Because maybe she's a person of nature. Maybe that's the most important aspect, a person of nature. So you're not going to say you don't like it because you might be afraid of offending me, but I won't be afraid. So this is Vincent van Gogh, and it's his picture of pollard willows at sunset. This is attributed to 1888. I think sometimes it's useful to look at the date of a picture, so you can get a better idea of what's going on. Post-impressionists painted a completely different world to the one that produced their colours, i.e. they were rural pictures rather than industrial pictures. And at this time, paints were being manufactured now. And 1797, rock discovered in Siberia extracted chromium, and that gave his chrome yellow. Van Gogh used it for sunflowers and for the asylum garden picture in Arles in 1889. Now, what can you see, what do you think is going on in his mind in the colours he's chosen? That's what I want you to tell me.
In this one and a gold leaf.
Yes.
The complementary colours.
Yes. Is he being an intellectual and using what he's learned about complementary colours?
Yes.
Well, yes, it could be that he was inward.
Life.
Yes.
Sunset.
Yes, could be.
Sunset shows almost like struggle within himself with the vitality and kind of light of the yellow, which is also represented.
And it also.
And then I mean the colour of indigo and blue.
Yes.
More like.
That's calming though, calming, isn't it?
Could be also more showing that he had this kind of extreme moods.
Yes. And he went between.
And he went between trying to find balance.
Because the yellow, as what I said, we knew he was a little bit disturbed and anxious from his youth. He didn't live that long. But it does work on the nervous system. It can make people very agitated. And maybe he knew that. Maybe that's why he used those colours. And the earth, of course, is an umber colour, and that's more grounding. So he's trying to perhaps relax into his environment, to bring himself down, make himself calm, get better even, you know. Anyone else got a view?
I think he's expressing his emotion. And yeah, to be honest, far from feeling calm, I think it's the opposite. I think he's moving those brushstrokes around as a trying to let out his frustration.
Yes.
And in a turmoil.
In an asylum.
He is, yes.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
It's not coming or anything.
Well, maybe he's saying, this is me.
Yes, I think he's saying. That's what I think.
He likes yellow.
Yes. True. Now we're looking at 1867, perhaps almost a contemporary, Pierre Bonnard. What do you think about this picture on the left here? It's called The Window, and it was painted 1925.
Restful.
Yeah. Pastel colours. Obviously bright light out there.
Optimistic.
Yes. It's a warm looking picture. He's got on the windowsill or the desk, he's got papers. He's obviously been, he's got a pad perhaps where he's been drawing, painting, an inkwell and some paper and a pen. So he's been writing. So
his favourite spot.
Yes.
It makes you feel cheerful when you look at that, isn't it?
Yes, it is. Thank you. Yeah. And perhaps he's sort of trying to communicate with the outside world, his ideas, his thoughts. This one here, which is called Coffee, was an earlier picture. And what do you think about the colours, the difference between them?
Much warmer.
Yes. Stronger, yes. Hmm. The checkered cloth. Yes. What about the figure that you can see? You can't see any of the other figures. They're faceless. And the dog, of course, next to her. And they're kind of separate from the other figures in the background. You can't see their faces.
Has so it been cut off, or was the painting like that?
Well, what I took from the print was like this.
Surprised that he cut the head off like that.
What about the pose of the woman in the picture with the dog? Can that tell you anything? She's very thoughtful, isn't she? She looks like she's not so happy, full of thought. She is wearing warm colour. Anything else?
Well, if you compare the two, to me, that one looks, that person's in the darker mood.
Yes. Optimistic.
Where they're at peace
also. Yes, more optimistic. Paul Gauguin, I can't pronounce his name, can't say it. Road in Tahiti, 1891. Can you tell me the colours that you can see?
Green. So we don't know, is somebody walking dressed in black or what?
Yes. Two people, one in blue, one in black. Yes, brown, and the mountains have got a kind of pinky hue, haven't they?
Yes.
Brown and pink.
It could be nighttime.
I think it's sunset.
And what's that white stuff at the top, on the right?
It looks like clouds over the top of the mountain, and behind another mountain. Gauguin used cadmium red and cerulean blue for the sky. And it's reminiscent of Alhambra, the red fortress. It's as if he's included it so as to give an impression of, you know, that colour. And it's a kind of warmish colour, isn't it, for a mountain? Twelve of the Impressionist painters' paints out of 20 that they used were inventions of chemistry by this time. Do you think he knew at this time what made the rocks that he used in his picture so colourful? Was he thinking of natural products maybe, or the things that he's used, or is that too intellectual?
That's too intellectual.
And when the materials were arranged with elements, and they were grouped together with the elements, our elemental scheme, into our periodic table, it unlocked chemists' understanding of what happens when we see colour. If you put it all together in the chemical form, and you compare it with what you're seeing, you can see how it's having an effect on your mind. And that's when they began to intellectualise colour. This is Paul Cézanne. Have you seen these pictures before?
No.
Okay. So I did well. I found things you hadn't seen. So now you can react to them as you see them, according to maybe the colours. The boy in red, 1889, it's been said that it represents himself as a child. And if you learn about Cézanne, he was quite dominated by his father, who didn't want him to be an artist. He wanted him to be a professional. And he just wasn't happy. I don't think he looks too happy in that picture. And he's painted himself with a very white face, not looking so well. But he's put himself in a red, perhaps velvet vest. And that may be indicating that he's going to be strong and stand up for his beliefs. That's my interpretation. What's yours?
Well, he feels passionate about his art.
I think so. Yeah, maybe. And he's wearing, looks like, blue trousers or jeans. I don't know if they had jeans in, as far back as then. But there's green patterns on the table. And I think the curtain is a dark green as well. So that might be indicative of moving towards improving his health or something like that. Have I exhausted you all? I can't think of anything now. Okay, what about the middle one? Pyramid of Skulls, 1900s. I don't know if you can see it, but there are four skulls. And one at the back is lying down. And what's the significance of that, you might ask yourself? The colours of the skulls. Two are rather golden and one is white. And he's painted himself with a whitish face. Does that indicate that he thinks of himself as the white skull? Or am I just a storyteller?
I think you're a storyteller.
What do you think? Why has he used those colours in such a startling subject?
Skulls are that sort of colour.
Are they? Okay.
In paintings, when you see skulls, they're usually that colour.
Yes.
Well, I never saw a skull which has a line in the middle.
No.
He had a cleaver. That's why he's a skull.
Yeah. And then the third one is of his father reading. That was a very early one, and that was painted at the time when he was having a lot of conflict with his father, apparently. But he nonetheless painted him in a very respectful way. Maybe he was trying to prove to his father that he was a good artist and that his father should invest in that. I don't know. But the father looks like he's ignoring him and he's very studious. Maybe that's a reflection on the father wanting him to study. So, Joaquin Sorolla, 1863 to 1923, is a recent exhibition of his work. And when I looked online, because I wasn't able to get there, I saw this glorious, glorious selection of colourful pictures. Well, you can't really see because you can't really see how they glow with light, the first two, whereas the third one is quite sad. So the one on the left is Boys on the Beach to 1908, and that is so full of sunlight on these bodies, it's just wonderful to behold. So what do you think about what he's trying to say?
He's just fascinated by the play of light, and he's trying to show light and youth and carefree happiness.
Yes, that's quite likely. And what about the middle one, the two girls? Women on the Beach. So these are young girls just enjoying themselves in an innocent way. And the far right one is something completely different. And 1899 is the earliest one, the white slave trade. And there are one, two, three, four women in that picture. Four, yes. And one is lying on this bench.
There is five.
Five. Yeah, one at the back, yes. And this one is lying down. She's thoroughly exhausted. And they're waiting. They're waiting to be collected. These are women who will be set up as prostitutes. And so it's a very somber picture. The expression on their faces are exhaustion and sadness. And he felt very, very strongly about what was going on. Of course, he was youthful and involved in his mind. And the colours are somber and heavy, which is quite interesting. So what mood is he conveying, and what emotion and what thoughts do you think he had? Can you tell me that? Sadness, yes, predominance of brown.
Was that to be somebody who tried to portray, you know, the problems in society?
Yes.
Obviously that was one of them.
Yes.
He felt angry about it.
Yes, indeed. Well, I sincerely hope that you've enjoyed this talk and picture show, and that you're reminded about how important colour is to us in our world and in our lives, because it affects all of us in one way or the other. And if you're an artist, maybe take a fresh look at pictures when you go to exhibitions and ask yourself, what does this say to me? And what did the artist who created it,
what were they
thinking when they put this together, choosing the colours that they did? And next time you begin to paint, ask yourself, what do I want my viewer to know and feel? And what colours could tell them that? Is that a good thought? Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this. Thank you. Thank you very much for coming. And if you have anything you'd like to ask me, I'll be here for a few minutes.
Okay,
thanks.
You.